Amen. I'm just pop. I'm not poppin'. So I'm just pop. Hallelujah. Amen. A bunch of people said yes. They like a song before I preach. Not for me. Phone calls from Athens, there's some problems. And so we prayed, and God directed us to come to Athens to check up on things. And I'm not going to talk about the problem today, because that's under the blood, that's history. But it was something Brother Okala said to me that stuck with me through the years. When I got to Athens, he says, "Pastor," he said, "we go to church," he said, "but the Holy Ghost stays outside when we go inside." And that was his way of expressing there's a big mess inside. God was not pleased. So that kind of illustrates what I'm going to preach about today. The fact that how we come to church makes a big difference. I was just so blessed and so filled with the presence of God today. If you walk into this church, yes, if not many people are talking, some are kneeling, some are greeting one another and all that, and you probably wouldn't have any idea what's fixing to happen here. But as soon as we start worshiping and we start praising, we start presenting ourselves to God, the climate, the atmosphere changes in here. Amen. Not that it's not good to have fellowship, but there's a time when we make presentation unto the Lord. And so I'm happy to announce that Brother Okala will be our main speaker at one of the speakers at our All Nations, what do we call it? It's not the conference, it's the All Nations Celebrations, where every country is going to have their little to do. And I always like that. I always enjoy that. Dressing up in our traditional garb and everything, and singing different languages and playing different instruments. And it's always a great time. It makes Crossroads Crossroads. I don't know if you can really find that any other place. Or you can go to, I've been to a lot of churches that have multi-ethnicities, but they don't take the time to enhance the individual cultures from time to time like we do at Crossroads. And it really adds color, it adds flavor to the menu here at Crossroads. Praise God. I'm going to read today's scripture. Brother Luther, I'm not going to read the whole text, but I'm going to read from verse 2 Chronicles chapter 5, and I'll read it starting at verse 11 through 14, I believe it is. Praise God. You can stand for the reading of the word. Number 11, it reads, "And it came to pass, when the priests were come out of the holy place," for all the priests that were present were sanctified and did not then wait by course. Also the Levites were the singers, all of them of Asaph and of Heman, and of Jeduthun, with their sons and their brethren, being arrayed in white linen, having cymbals and psalteries and harps, stood at the east end of the altar. and with them 120 priests sounding trumpets. And it came to pass, as the trumpeters and the singers were as one, to make one sound to be heard in praising and thanking the Lord. And when they had lifted up their voice with the trumpets and cymbals and instruments of music, and praised the Lord, saying, "For he is good, for his mercy endureth forever," that then the house was filled with a cloud, even the house of the Lord. I'm also going to read Hebrews chapter 9, verse 11. "But Christ, being come an high priest of good things to come, by a greater and more perfect tabernacle, not made with hands, that is to say, not of this building." Gracious Father, I ask your anointing and blessing on this word today. Dear God, I pray that you would help us, O Lord Jesus, to minister to your church, to your body, that they may be edified, sanctified, purified, and to be glorified. God, I pray this, O God, because I acknowledge before this great congregation and before your presence, Lord, that I am a man, I have nothing to offer. But God, if you will somehow unlock the keys to my soul and my spirit, and those words that you have placed inside of me, that they will come out in such a way that people will understand and that they will accept and receive. Oh Lord, I pray in the name of Jesus, I ask it. Amen. And you may be seated today. I want to preach today on the subject of, I've had a lot of different names, but I think I'm going to call it the quality of presentation today. The quality of presentation today. In the Bible and history, there has never been a dedication compare with Solomon's temple or the dedication of Solomon's temple. The building alone said took people's breath away. The Queen of Sheba came, and when she beheld all that Solomon had done, the scripture says she lost her breath and said, "The half has not been told me." It was a building, it was an awesome building. And they had come to dedicate this building. And how can I compare this? You know, if I'm going to eat at Goodies, any old thing will do. I can be sloppy looking. I can be 2 days beard. I can have my tennis shoes on and my blue jeans on. It's okay. I can go to Goodies and everything's okay. But everybody else is in there just about like that. But now, if I'm gonna go to a little finer restaurant, you know, where they have nice table settings and they've got this, the forks and the spoons and the napkins and the plates and the salad bowls and everything's just like that. And as soon as you step into that place, you realize this is a fine dining restaurant. And I think it would just be natural to want to dress accordingly. If I walk into a nice restaurant like that and everybody's there in coats and ties real nice and pretty and boutonnieres and everything, well then I think, oh, I'm not dressed enough. I'm not prepared to eat in this restaurant. And so there's a sense inside of you that you realize that with this particular area or place, it requires a little step up in preparation to be there. Amen. Otherwise, I would be eating and I would be thinking everybody's eyes are looking at that poor man over there that don't either have any money or don't have good sense to dress up. Praise the Lord. How many of you like to dress up every now and then, huh? That's why we have the banquets. That's so we can take out our best and put it on and dress up. I don't know, it makes me feel good about myself when I can spiff up, you know. I was looking in the mirror this morning because Mom is not here with me at this moment, and just checking everything out. Have you ever tried to tie a tie? It can get aggravating because you can tie it and it's going to be too short. It's going to look like somebody cut it off. Or you can tie it and it's going to be that too long. But then, you know, after a while, you kind of learn. This morning, I tried one tie, a real nice knot in my tie because I said, you know, Sister Daniela might be there. Or Sister Benu, or maybe some of them. They're gonna be there, and I want to look and have a nice time today. And so I started trying to tie it, but the tie is not long enough to tie the tie that I would like. See, there's, you know, you go by ties. There's short ties, medium ties, and long ties. And so this particular beautiful tie, I put my favorite jacket out this morning, and I got my favorite snazzy, pretty tie on today. I laid it out on the bed there, and I was proud. And when I went to go tie the tie, I was going to put a double Windsor knot in there to make it look cha-cha-cha, you know. But when I did it, and I got it all down, I cinched it up around my neck, and I looked down, and it came to about where my belly button is. And that just, it looks so, I look like a cartoon character or some kind of a comedian, a clown. So I had to undo it all and start all over. And I had to take out a loop so that my tie would be long enough. But this kind of knot don't stay straight so good. So anyhow, I felt the need to try and present myself today in a little bit better way. Because it's Sunday at the crossroads. Why not? Welcome home, Joe. Oh, Joe Clo. Amen. And so, thinking of this, of presentations, you know, weddings, everybody gets, oh man, weddings. Do people spend a lot of money on weddings? Just pop, circumstance, fluffed up, puffed up, bowed up, ruffled up. Amen. And there's a lot of tradition and ceremony and things to make a wedding be a wedding. You can run off and get married, but that wife will hate you the rest of her life. So my wife and I, we had a very simple wedding. We didn't have money, we didn't have the time, and so we was on college break. And in fact, my in-laws weren't happy about her marrying into an apostolic church. They were Catholic. And ever since then, since I've been pastoring, I've tried to make every guy that comes to me say, "Now you take a honeymoon. I'm not going to marry you if you don't take a honeymoon." Because I learned it was important although my wife and I kind of agreed, but really in her heart she would have liked that honeymoon. And so as a result, I have to take honeymoons for the rest of my life every now and then to make up for the one. Gotta get a witness. And believe me, brothers, it's important to keep that lady happy. Keep her on your side. Praise God. Life will go a whole lot better. So anyhow, this was a presentation being made. We call it a dedication, but really it was a presentation. Solomon had taken everything his father had gathered, and everything that was in his father's heart. The scripture says that it was in David's heart to build a temple, but God said, no, your son will build the temple. And so Solomon was trying to fulfill all the vision that his father had. So he took everything his father had gathered in the way of funds and materials to start building this temple. And now it was finished. And he was going to present it. He was presenting it first unto God. God, this is the temple that we build in honor of my father, but this temple is for you. And so it was a presentation as much of as a dedication. And the presentation was off the charts. I mean, they had massive choirs. They had orchestras playing. They had cymbals and chimes and harps and harpsichords and all sorts of instruments playing and making music. And at one point and at one moment in the presentation of the dedication, the scripture says that they all became as one. Everything just clicked. You know how it is around here sometimes, you know, we kind of, on a few, the little group over here getting it, and one or two back there getting it, and, but not everybody, but rarely, not often enough, everybody, amen, connects, and we're in the flow, and man, what a great time we have. What happens, God does in the midst of his people. And this is a situation, I want you to get the picture of this awesome grand temple that Solomon had built. And all the trappings that went with it, all the preparation and all the detailed people. Some of you people that perhaps work in catering, or you are working in some of the more wealthy homes in the country, and they're wanting to put on a big shebang for their friends and their guests or something like that, and you almost hate that to happen because you have to work extra doubly hard because they want everything in the right place. And believe me, them employers, they're not Jesus. Amen. If there's one little spot on a spoon that the dishwasher didn't dry and they'll see that spot, they'll fuss at you because it wasn't spotless. And boys, well, you're trying your best, amen. And even when you have done your best, the devil gets in there somehow and allows the wrong plate in the wrong place, or so. Or there was a crack, or there was the dishwasher that didn't do his job. Something, there's always some little fly in the ointment, we say, a little sand in the gears. But nonetheless, you can realize what I'm trying to say here about this presentation of the temple. Solomon wanted everything to be just right. Amen. They was trying to present this temple to the Lord. And so along with getting the singers there with their instruments and dressed right and appropriate and getting all the horn players there with all their instruments warmed up and ready, what it takes just to play music, something you gotta tune the things. You gotta get them, sometimes you gotta warm up. You go to an orchestra, You walk in there, they just don't walk over and sit down and start playing. They get there hours before the concert takes place, and they get all those instruments, and you got to warm them up. You got to blow it, because as you blow, they get warmer, and when they get warmer, they expand, and the tunes can get off simply because of your air going through the horns. Isn't that something? And so they have a preliminary tuning. Everybody get in tune, but just before they start the program, you'll hear a tuning. Have you ever been to a concert? Big time. And just before they start, you'll hear doo. That's everybody. They're getting make sure everything's just right. And so is the case here with Solomon making this presentation. I want you to get the picture of how detailed and how fine everything was to be. And it was. And so it actually in the annals of presentation, it was off the charts. It was part of the presentation of all presentations of all times. So with all the choir and the singing and there was like one sound, praising and thanking God. His mercy endureth forever, they sang. And the Shekinah glory of a cloud filled the house. And their voices and their noises, amen, came before the Lord. It did something to the atmosphere, so much as that a cloud was formed. We're all familiar with the shout out that we've done here not too long ago, a few days ago, months ago, and how Brother Storm King mentioned that shouting shreds the air. Well, this thanksgiving and worshiping, amen, as our voice lifted up, it's not shouting, but if shouting can shred the air, music can probably organize the air, amen, to sound good and sweet and cause there to be a cloud, because the presence of God has entered in the praises of the people He inhabits them. Praise God. Did you know that when we were praising and singing earlier, you know that God comes into the middle of all of that, because He wants that. He created us for that purpose and for that reason. Amen. So much effort and care was focused upon the presentation that it captured the individual to comply with the moment. In other words, I saw this dear little sister here today, and V-Sung, what was her first name? I forgot. Okay. This is her first time, evidently, to Apostolic Pentecostal Church, maybe. And while everybody was in the moment, her and a few others, nothing wrong with that, nothing embarrassing about that, but they just didn't know what to do, how to handle the situation. But there's a eventually you see them start clapping their hands a little bit as they see what's happening. Sometimes they'll even raise their hands and pray. I remember my wife, the first time she came to a Pentecostal church, these were her words. Lord, if you ever let me out of here, I'll never come back. That's what she said. Praise God. But the Lord got a hold of her. Amen. And so the individual, that's me and that's you. When we're in this place, the individual feels compelled to comply with the moment. Is that simple enough? You understand? From my my vantage point up here, a lot of times we have worship services, things going on, and there's always a handful of people that are not here. They're here in their body, but they're not here in their spirit, in their mind, their thoughts. Amen. But a lot of times as this worship goes on, more people get into the moment. So now those in the back tend to get onto the train last. If our worship and praise was a train leaving the station, some of you, a lot of you are in the caboose. But thank God you got on the train. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Brother Eddie, for sitting right there where you belong and smiling real big and amen. That's a good man, Brother Eddie. And it's important that we comply to the moment. See, God must like, I think God likes presentations. Because I find in the New Testament at least three places where presentations took place. Amen. And that's what I want to preach about today. Realizing that we are participants in presentations. Praise God. Three presentations. One is you present yourself. According to Romans chapter 12, verse 1, it says, I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that ye present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. Did you get that? It said to present your bodies. It didn't say present your mind, present your soul, present your spirit. He said present your bodies. You hear so much people, oh, the outside doesn't matter. Just so you have a good heart. Well, that's a lie from hell. Well, the Bible don't say that anywhere. Paul writing to the Roman church, just across the Ionian Sea there. There's a place called Italy, there's a place called Rome, and Paul is writing to the Romans, and he said, I beg you, he said, I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that ye present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. Now, brothers and sisters, I want to preach a little bit here today on some of this stuff. But you have an obligation. You have a duty to be presenting yourself, body, soul, and spirit. Just like I said, Brother O'Connell, when he said, we go to church, but we go in, the Holy Ghost stays out. And he don't know what a true statement that was. Perhaps he meant it humorously, but it is very true. Amen. We have come to make a presentation. We come here to make a presentation. We are daily presenting ourselves before God, our bodies and our spirits, amen, unto the Lord. But we cannot say, I can live any way I want to, I can dress any way I want to, I can act like I want to, and I can still be in grace with God. The Bible doesn't say that. Amen. God sees everything about us. How can you say that my body does not affect my spirit or my spirit does not affect my body when the Bible says you're not whole unless your body, soul, and spirit. That is the total person. Body, soul, and spirit. And so our presentation first is we present ourselves unto God. Now, in actuality, this aspect of presentation of ourselves is proving the will of God, being in the will of God. The main objective here is to be filled with love, to be filled with humility, to be committed in our hearts, and to be filled with purity. Hebrews 2 and 3 says this. We'll just put up 1, 2, and 3. It says, therefore, we ought to give the more earnest heed. Anybody know what the word heed means? That's pay attention to it. Observe it. Actually, it has a little stronger meaning, I think, but to take heed lest you fall is the word it used in another place. Lest at any time we should let them slip. I'm going to take heed to the things which we have heard, lest at any time we should let them slip. For if the word spoken by angels was steadfast, and every transgression and disobedience received the just recompense of reward. He's saying if the angels were punished, if the angels were cast out, if the angels were disciplined because of what they spoke and because of every word that they said, how much more should we get an even reward? If they got punished, we should get punished. If they got disciplined, we should get disciplined. Verse 3. How shall we escape if we neglect so great salvation, which at the first began to be spoken by the Lord and was confirmed unto us by them that heard him, God also bearing them witness? Praise the Lord. Presenting yourself. Brothers and sisters, we cannot be sloppy in our Christianity. We cannot grow lax. My summertime is coming on, and there's just a natural laziness in the air. But we can't allow it to bleed over into our spirituality and into our presentation of ourselves unto God. You see, God sees you everywhere you go. All the time. God knows us. His eyes are watching. Amen. And so, just because we go to the beach doesn't give us excuse to become nude and take all of our clothes off. Amen. Modesty is for everywhere. Modesty is for all places. Praise God. So, let us be careful. Take heed. Take heed to what you say. And I know we spend a whole lot of time preaching on love and gossip and all these things to try and to expunge them out of the congregation so that we can have a more quality presence and communion with God inside the church, so God don't have to stay outside and guard the elevators, but he can actually come inside. Because we have prepared ourselves. We are presenting ourselves correctly and properly before God. Can I get a witness? Amen. You know, love and purity are so close. You read the epistles of John, and he keeps using these words, love, pure, love, purity. They're just so close together. And then humility. Humility is the soil, Sister Betty was speaking today, in which all virtues grow out of. You can be great in many things, but if you don't have a humility about you, it's just kind of wasted. People see the arrogance and the pride above all the good qualities you have. Now, you've heard that. Oh, he's a good guy. He does a lot of good things, but he's so stinking arrogant, you don't like, you know. Am I preaching today?
Amen.
Amen. Hallelujah. You want me to preach louder and faster, or are you going okay here? All right, because I don't care about fast, and I don't care about loud, as long as you understand. You got to get it. You can say, what preacher? I don't know, but it was fast and it was loud. Well, I didn't get nothing. I just got fast and loud, you know. Praise the Lord. And so we need to take heed. I think it's Solomon said, the little foxes spoil the vines. Amen. Oh, I'm not an alcoholic. I'm not a drunkard. But you can take that first sip. Oh, it's just, I'm just being social. Just kind of fit in here a little bit. So they hand you a little shot of ouzo or sake or raki. Hallelujah. And so amen. But every alcoholic, once upon a time, took his first sip. Amen. I'm not talking to people here today that are going to be alcoholics, I don't believe, but I'm just trying to make an illustration. Little things. I know I said this a while back, but anyhow, one sister one time, she thought if she would cut the ends of her hair off, it would grow. And so she went to the beautician, and he said, sister, what have you done? She said, I don't cut the ends off my hair so it would grow. He said, stupid. Hair don't grow at the end, it grows from the roots. But the devil can tip you, just cut that. Oh, there's a hair is just flying around, it keeps getting in my way and all that. You know what? It gets easier to do it again. I'm talking about God's covering for women. Okay? In the text there is no mention of silk or cotton or some synthetic material. When it talks about covering, there's only one commodity there that is mentioned, and it's hair. Hair. Although I wasn't cutting a little bit of hair, I'm still good. Well, you know that's where I personally believe, in the garden. That's what Eve did. In the cool of the evening, God came around looking for them. And they said, where art thou? She said, I'm hiding. Why? Why are you hiding? Because the Bible said when she ate the fruit, took the bite of that fruit, her eyes were enlightened for knowledge and understanding. And I think when she ran to Adam and she saw Adam had short hair and she had long hair, she wanted to be the authority. She wanted see, well, Adam's the boss. Maybe if I cut this hair off, I can be the boss. Now, there's very little Bible to back that up. But we do know that the scripture tells for a woman to allow her hair to continue to grow. That's the word kumal. A woman's hair, or combing in Greek, is her covering. So when we just flippantly just think, oh well, that's nothing, it's something. We put ourselves in danger. You put yourselves in danger. I've noticed over the years when sisters backslide, the first things they do is to put on pants and to cut their hair. Because the rebellion is in their heart. They don't want to be submitted to authority. They don't want to be submitted to a pastor or an elder or even a husband, perhaps, or parents. It's a spirit of rebellion. And the spirit of rebellion is a sin of witchcraft. You know, as a pastor, as a shepherd, you pick up these signs of people whose hearts have turned. It don't happen overnight. But there's a turn that takes place, and they start slowly, 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 slowly drifting. They will try to stay in fellowship until finally their heart has turned black enough to where they say, I don't care, I'm going to do it my way. And out the door they go. Or they got an, I'm going to go somewhere else, because they are not so strict as Strickland. Amen. No. Because they don't want to hear the word. I thank God for my pastors that preach to me the word. Now, this is not my intent to say all this today that I've said already, especially on these issues here, but still, it is part of what I'm talking about. When you come to the church, you're coming to present yourself a holy and dedicated vessel unto God. Praise the Lord. And thank God for the mercies. If you fail, God not going to throw you in hell at that instant. There's an altar. If you mess up and you realize that you are heading in the wrong direction, there's a place to get back in touch with God. There's a place where you can go to God and find mercy. Because when I read that, why were they singing in the temple that day? What was the main song they sang that day? Did anybody pick that up when we read the text? It said that they had become as one and they were singing, mercy of the Lord endureth forever. Mercy of the Lord endureth forever. Oh, hallelujah. Let me tell you, the mercy of the Lord endureth forever. There's no need to run away unless you are just stubborn and rebellious. And that's what the Bible says. It's all the same. Because you can always get it right. You can always come to find mercy with God.
Yes.
Hallelujah. And God loves you. He wants you to stay. He don't want you to leave. I was talking to some fellow here a while back, and they didn't like the preacher. Didn't like the preacher. And I said, well, sir, I said, the preacher is the authority that God has placed in your life. And it's not easy to be a preacher or to be a pastor. It's not easy. I don't know. You say, well, you don't get in the sun. You're not out there digging. No. That's a different kind of difficulty. Amen. It's a spiritual heart difficulty. Trying to deal with people that don't care about themselves. That's the hard one. You try to help people and they don't want to help themselves. And you cry over them and you plead with God, Lord, what about so and so? What would please God? Help them out there, Lord Jesus. Amen. Praise God. But eventually people that have this rebellion in their heart will try to get as far away from authority as they can. They don't want authority. But if you're going to serve the Lord, you're going to be under authority somewhere, some way, somehow. Amen. Let me go on. Give heed to. Little foxes can spoil vine. That's what I was talking about. Just a little snips can. Amen. And actually, I've already advised people in leadership to be watching out for the little foxes. Because it's getting too easy to miss church. It's getting too easy to not come to prayer meeting. It's getting too easy to put on a little color on the face. It's getting too easy to try and make those lips redder. It's getting too easy, amen, for little snip here and a little snip there. But I'm not giving up on you. Hallelujah. We're going to just keep preaching it and loving you. Hallelujah. Until you wake up.
Amen.
Isn't that right, Brother Tarun? T-Run? Amen. All right. I like that witness there. Praise God. Now then, not to belabor this, this is the first presentation. We present ourselves. And the important thing here, I believe, is we get our heart in such a condition, get our life, our body, our soul, our spirit in such a condition that it loves, that it is humble, that it is committed to the Word of God, and that it's pure. If you can just work on those things, I'm working real hard to love. I'm working real hard to be humble. I'm not gonna keep pride and arrogance out. I'm gonna be committed to the Word of God, and I'm gonna be faithful. And just the details will take care of themselves, most of them. But when we start getting a little pride, a little arrogance, that, hey, man, nobody can pray like I pray. Amen. I speak in tongues more than you all. Hallelujah. Did you hear me give the prayer request, man? When I was on fire. Did you hear Pastor complimented me? Pastor, just let everybody know what a good spirit I am.
That's right.
Well, don't blow that trumpet too loud.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Amen. Because bubbles pop. Egos burst. Amen. It's better. Well, praise God. I want to move off of that. I didn't come here to grind on that. But the next presentation is the presentation of the ministry to the Lord. says in 2 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 2, "For I am jealous over you with godly jealousy. For I have espoused you to one husband, that I may present you as a chaste virgin to Christ." Paul said, "I have preached, I have taught, I've jumped up and down, I've fasted and I've prayed. For what reason? So that I can present you before the Lord as a pure virgin." He further says, Colossians 1, and I'm going to read 15 through 22. "Who is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of every creature? For by him were all things created that are in heaven and that are in earth, visible and invisible, whether they be thrones or dominions or principalities or powers. All things were created by him and for him. And he is before all things, and by him all things consist. And he is the head of the body, the church, who is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, that in all things he might have the preeminence. For it pleased the Father that in him should all fullness dwell. And having made peace through the blood of his cross, by him to reconcile all things unto himself, by him, I say therefore, they be things of earth or things in heaven. And you that were sometimes alienated and enemies in your mind by wicked works, yet now hath he reconciled in the body of his flesh through death to present you holy and unblameable and unreprovable in his sight." Praise God. If you continue in the faith, grounded and settled. Amen. But the presentation is to be without spot. Amen. Try a different detergent in the washing, in the dishwasher, and not put spots on the spoon. It's okay. Hallelujah. But without spot and without blemish, praise God. A person that can be unblameable and unreprovable in his sight. Words, the Lord can't find nothing wrong. You have presented yourself, and the Lord just, well done. Now, I thank God for that mercy. Well, I thank God for that mercy, because I want to come to church. And I want to present myself in such a way that I can be a part of the moment and the blessing and the glorification and all that. I want to be a part of that. But I know in my conscience that there's probably a little bit of something that I need to get under the blood, that I need to leave it outside. Because when the Lord begins to bless, I don't want to be like Achan the sinner who had stolen the stuff and caused a big problem. And so I thank God for the mercy that I can come in here and I can search my heart. Amen. And say, "My God, have mercy on me. Forgive me of my sins. Forgive me of my wicked ways. Lord, make me holy and pure and righteous in your eyes." So when you can look at me and you can say, "Well done. You're good." Hello, baby. So we can come into the house and we can just lift up holy hands. It says, come to lift up holy hands without wrath, without doubting. I don't hate anybody. I'm not wishing revenge on anybody. Only thing I want to beat up is the devil.